Okay, everyone, last session of the day. Everybody still with us? Still awake? Perfect, we made it. Our next session is entitled The Top 10 Mistakes Leaders Make. So Mr. Corey is going to tell me about everything I do wrong. David Corey is a coach and leadership development specialist known for his expertise in applying the concept of emotional intelligence to leadership development for individual and organizational performance improvement. And in addition to bachelor's degrees in kinesiology and education, David has achieved a master's degree in adult education. He is a certified professional coactive coach, CPCC, and a certified master trainer in the area of emotional intelligence with MHS Incorporated, and is considered to be an international expert on the integration of emotional intelligence and leadership development, and is frequently invited to be a keynote speaker at conferences worldwide. Welcome, Mr. Corey.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here. It's great to be with all of you. Coming to you from my backyard. Not really, of course. I'm in Calgary today, and this is not what Calgary looks like. However, we all make mistakes. And when leaders make mistakes, those have big organizational impacts. And we want to, based on my 24 years of coaching leaders, training leaders in the most progressive organizations on the planet worldwide, I've come to notice that there are about 10 mistakes that leaders make, and these are not technical mistakes. These are the kind of mistakes that people make based on the fact that we don't teach children about relationships. We don't teach children about how to communicate clearly and well. We don't teach children how to fix damaged relationships, and we leave that to chance. And so it's so interesting that we educate our children on reading, writing, arithmetic, and all those important things. And those are important things, but we don't teach them some of the things that are come to be more important than anything else, ultimately, in what makes our lives what makes our lives successful and allows us to thrive. So let me just do a little poll here. Those of you who are online, I can see there's a lot of you online, so I can ask you, and maybe in the room, if we could just, you know, by show of hands, I want to take a look at a bit of a list here, and tell me, have you experienced any of the following from a leader in an organization? So number one, if it's number one, you can maybe just enter an exclamation mark into the chat box if you've experienced number one. A leader comes up to you and you've been secretly told something personal about another colleague. I don't know if that's ever happened. It certainly happened to me. I don't know if it's happened to you or not. What about witnessing a leader giving humiliating feedback to a team member in a meeting, kind of in an open forum? There's other peers there at the meeting, and it can be humiliating. And so let me know if you've ever heard that one. Again, for those of you who are online on Zoom, just type in an exclamation mark into the chat box. I should probably ask the organizers if that's even possible. Can people type into the chat box? Let's see. Maybe they can. If we can make that possible, that would be awesome. How about number three? You're expected to deal with a distraught employee. So your manager or a leader in the organization says, hey, this person is in some sort of distress. Why don't you deal with them? And kind of just leaves you with them. Then number four, how about you had a great idea that your leader claimed as their own? It's not necessarily happened to me, but I've heard it happen, and I know that it does happen. Number five, you are denied vacation time because of work while your boss takes a holiday. So you have to work and you have to show up and be there, but your boss feels like it's okay for them. There's different rules for your boss than there is for you. So we have this opportunity to take a look at some of the other kinds of mistakes that leaders make and think about them in terms of, so chat's disabled, but Q&A is open. All right, so great. So that would be the one where we would expect to see some responses there in the Q&A box. So we'll use that to communicate with each other. I'll monitor that and try to keep looking at the Q&A box as we go through. What does this have to do with? What is this based on? Why are people making these kinds of mistakes, doing these kinds of things that impacts heavily on the organization and organizational effectiveness? So we're gonna talk about each of the mistakes that I've identified here. We'll talk about the corresponding beliefs that people have to have in order to make these kinds of mistakes. And we'll talk about this concept of emotional intelligence, what it has to do with this, and the impact of those mistakes on employees. So, okay, let's start with this concept of emotional intelligence. Well, you may have heard of emotional intelligence. It's been talked about. People have a growing familiarity with this idea. And really, the reason that we have this concept of emotional intelligence, that we're talking about it at all, is because this is where we are in our evolution as a species. We are finally at this point where we are turning inward. And we're looking at those scary, weird, wonderful things called emotions. And the reason that this is gaining prominence now is because in 1990, Bell Laboratories invented the functional magnetic resonance imaging technology that we now use in many, many hospital applications and healthcare applications. But one of the things that they discovered about the brain when they first started using fMRI was that emotions are far more involved in human behavior than we ever thought before. In fact, whereas you may have thought previously that you could leave emotions out of it, that is not physiologically possible. Emotions are involved in everything we do. Emotions move us to take action. Emotions focus our attention on the things that we need to attend to. Emotions provide us with data about our environment, about people, about communication and relationships so that we can be more effective. We have to get away from this idea of emotional intelligence as something that is soft and fuzzy, that is about group hugs. Although I don't know about you, but I like group hugs, but it's not about group hugs. It's about much more than that. It's about effective human behavior. And the reason that we've been involved in leadership development for the past 24 years is because organizations recognize that by investing in leaders, they see a return on that investment in terms of organizational effectiveness. And when leaders understand these skills, leaders are able to build better relationships, communicate more clearly, and handle issues that come up in the workplace in an effective way that maintains those relationships and keeps people providing their discretionary effort, keeps employees engaged. It attracts top talent. And creates cultures of psychological safety where people feel free to innovate and make their best contribution. So these are the kinds of things that we want to encourage in the workplace, but we also have to resource people. We have to give them skills and abilities and train them and coach them in order to be able to do these things. So you can see here that in this model, we've got the concept of emotional intelligence at the center. There is a Center for the Study of Emotional Intelligence at Yale University. It's been in operation for many years. There are about 50 PhDs all working on how can we help people to understand more about this concept and how can we help people to be more effective in using the skills of emotional intelligence. Again, recognizing that emotions are at the root of and involved in everything we do. So we need to be more intelligent about them. So this model answers the question, what would you do if you wanted to be more intelligent about emotions? Well, you would perceive yourself in healthy ways. You'd regard yourself as someone who's confident and competent to do what you do. You'd know yourself really well. You'd understand your own priorities and your own values and your own emotions at a deep level. To do that, we have to challenge some traditional beliefs. There are traditional beliefs out there about emotions, especially for we men. One of the first things we men learn about our own emotions is that big boys don't cry. So I guess our emotions are to be ignored and denied and not communicated to others. And then we grow up and we want to have better relationships, and we have to learn. We have to challenge those traditional beliefs and then learn how to express our emotions if we want deep and meaningful relationships with others. So there's that self-perception piece. There's a self-expression piece. There's an interpersonal relationship part to this. And there's an express component of this model, which is dedicated to how emotion and logic and reason work together. Two parts of our brains, as you may know, and this is important that that we understand how these two parts of our brains work in concert with each other to provide excellent outcomes. Without it, we fall victim to things like unconscious bias, things like avoidance, worry, procrastination, and the lack of impulse control, which allows us to get to the root cause of issues in the workplace. Finally, stress is such a big part of our lives, our work, that it's important that we understand more about how to deal with and cope with the stress that we experience, so that we can experience stress without a drop in performance. So let's take a look at some of those mistakes. First, let's take a look at a page from an emotional quotient inventory report. That model that you saw on the previous page is the basis for the first scientifically validated measure for emotional intelligence in the world. And it's the world's leading emotional intelligence measure. It was created in 1997. Well, it was created in the early 80s by Dr. Reuven Baron. And then after many years of postdoctoral research, it was finally published by a Canadian publishing company called MHS in 1997. This is the 2.0 version. And this is a sample page from a report showing that you get scores in these various areas that are compared to a representative sample of the population. What we can see here, and what I want to point out, is that higher is not necessarily always better. What is better is a balance of these various skills and competencies. In this case, this happens to unfortunately come from an actual coaching client of mine who was terminated. Why was he terminated? He was terminated because I was a bad coach. No, it wasn't that so much as it was we didn't have enough time together. I thought I was starting to make some real progress, but in terms of the senior executive, it wasn't enough. It was too little too late for him. He has this very high emotional expression score at 121. The mean is 100, standard deviation is 15. So between 85 and 115 is a typical range where most people in the population score. So here's got this high emotional expression score of 121 and this very low impulse control score of 72. So he was very emotionally expressive, but he couldn't regulate his own emotional expression. He was not appropriately expressing his emotions in the right way to the right people at the right time. And this led to all kinds of dysfunctional relationships for him, dysfunctional communication, and he was ultimately let go. So that's just a sample of what we can understand by looking at EQI scores. And I want to refer to them while I talk about the mistakes that leaders make. So we can think about these various competencies, these EQ competencies, if you will, emotional quotient. One's emotional quotient is what you get from the EQI. And it is all about how well or how poorly you use these various skills and competencies. So we want to understand our default setting. For those of you who are familiar with the mixing board that you might find in a recording studio, imagine there are 15 of these sliders that slide up and down, and you are in charge of those sliders. However, you have come to a default setting through your life experiences. So your family of origin, the schools you went to, your cultural background, even your gender plays a role in how well or how poorly you do some of these things. But in general, we are fairly unaware of our default mode unless we intentionally join a program where we are assessing ourselves and understanding more about our own default settings so that we can be more intentional about them. With awareness and intention, we can choose to do things differently if we want greater effectiveness in our work and in our lives. So we need to understand what our high scores are, what our low scores are, and when our EQ competencies are out of balance. So let's understand a bit more about some of those mistakes. Mistake number one is because I said so. My partner Jill and I, both business and life partners, we came up with these because we could think of and recall certain leaders in our own experience and in our coaching practice, where leaders have this belief that they know best. This is a traditional belief of leadership, that leaders know more than everyone else and should know more than everyone else and be able to say how things go because they said so. In order to do this, what we frequently see that goes along with this is a high score in self-regard. So people are feeling pretty good about themselves. However, how it comes across to others is as arrogant or as even intimidating or dominant. That's not a good impact that you want to have as a leader on others. The lower EQ competency we felt here was a bit lower in stress tolerance. This is what we're doing is a bit of a reflex action. Rather than reacting, we want people to not necessarily react, but we want them to respond in a thoughtful way. This requires impulse control, as we'll see. But it's interesting that some leaders make this mistake of because I said so. It was infuriating as kids when our parents said because I said so, because we actually wanted a rationale. We wanted to understand why we were being told certain things, and so do employees in the organization. They want to understand the rationale behind it. Why are we doing it this way? So we're looking for thoughtful responses, not the because I said so answer that was so infuriating to us when we were kids. So that's mistake number one. This is not an exhaustive list by any means. It's not thorough empirical research. It's just what we've noticed and what we think from working with so many leaders in so many different kinds and types of organizations over many years. So that's mistake number one. Mistake number two, and what I'm hoping is that I'll get through the content and then we can have some time for questions and answers. But by all means, if you want to type in a question at any time, please feel free to use that Q&A box. I will have it open on my desktop so that I can see it, and I'm happy to respond in the moment. So mistake number two, I heard this from, it happened to be a woman executive in an oil and gas company. And she said, in this company, you die before you cry. And what she was talking about was the lack of acceptance around an expression of emotions. And that if you were having a difficult time, if you were struggling, you were not to let on, you were not to talk about that and make that known. It's based on the belief that emotions are weak and interfere with decision-making. And once again, as I mentioned, emotions are neither weak nor strong, they just are. And then it's about what you do with them. As I may have also mentioned, emotions are data. What is that data telling us? And the more we understand about emotions, which are simply reactions, biochemical reactions in response to stimuli in our environment, the more we understand about what that data is for and what it's telling us, the more effective we're going to be ultimately. So we have to pay attention to them. And then it's important to be able to express them, be able to understand how they can interfere and or support our application of logic and reason, etc. So the very high EQ competency that we figured was probably at play here was independence. To believe that emotions are weak and interfere with decision-making, you rely on your own energies and your own steam. And you know these people. They're the people who never ask for help, think asking for help is weak. They're the people who will just go ahead and do things, will plow ahead, do things on their own. Now, the problem with that is that, and it's very entrepreneurial, and it's probably also a bit of an issue for some entrepreneurs, it is in asking for help and support. You probably know this, that nothing ever great in the history of the world was ever accomplished alone. It was always in partnership with others as a team. And it's so interesting whenever they have an Olympics and you see that that athlete standing on the podium. If we were to include everyone who got that athlete to that podium position, they wouldn't fit on the podium. There's just too many people. There's the parents who drove them every morning to the rink or wherever they went to do their sport, et cetera, et cetera, and on and on. And so we have to understand that yes, it is important to be able to be independent and not dependent on others. However, it's even far more important to be interdependent. But we have to be independent first before we enter into relationships with others. Otherwise, there's a strong risk of that relationship ending up in dependency. So all of these things, once again, are critical and important in balance with each other. The low EQ competency is low emotional self-awareness. So we've got people who don't pay attention to their emotions because they don't believe they're important, and they've never been encouraged to pay attention to their emotions, to sort of make those emotions front and center for them. They've not done that, and they believe that people who do pay attention to their emotions or express their emotions are weak, and that so they're more robotic in their responses to things. And this is interesting because in many technical fields, as you know, those of you who work in technical fields, you know that technical fields attract people who have a preference for introversion. What that means is that they are not necessarily outgoing. They are not they don't necessarily process out loud and with others, but they like to sort of take information away and think about it. And in some cases, they would prefer working on their own versus with other people. But in every technical field, you go to your professional school and you learn your technology, and then you have to work in teams. Then if you want to be promoted, if you want to go up the ladder, so to speak, then you've got to develop your leadership skills. And to do that requires that you develop your people skills. And to do that requires that you know and understand more about and practice the skills of emotional intelligence. So this is what we're talking about here. We're talking about the science of people skills. For a long time, we've called them soft skills. And the problem with calling it soft skills is it indicates that it's somehow, an add-on or a nice to have, not necessarily the necessary to have that it actually is. For our very effectiveness. So die before you try. You may have experienced a leader who had that that kind of attitude towards things, and they're difficult to deal with. You don't ever really get to know them very well because they don't tell you much about themselves. You have to guess. You have to guess, you know, what's going on for them on any particular day, what kind of mood they're in, and there's that element of shifting sands at the same time. Very difficult for leaders who have this approach to build trust, because trust comes about when we really know someone. We don't trust what we don't know, and if people don't express their emotions or tell others about them, then it's very difficult to trust them. Okay, and you can see this, and I think that this little image that I chose here, real bosses don't let their emotions get in the way of business. I think this guy really thought that this was a good thing, that this was something to be celebrated, and that I think he was serious about this. And I'm thinking to myself, real bosses actually acknowledge their own emotions and share them with others. That's what real bosses do, at least effective bosses, the kind we want to stay working for, the kind that we have a loyalty and commitment to. But actually, this is not something to be taken seriously at all. It's a traditional belief, and it's somewhat archaic at this particular time in our development as human beings. Mistake number three is Suck it up, princess. You may have heard this before. I chose this little image over here to put on the slide. Sweat dries, blood clots, bones heal. Suck it up, princess. And you may have experienced that. And this comes about from many senior leaders, CEOs, who believe that everybody should handle stress like they do, and don't understand necessarily why people are struggling or having a difficult time. In fact, one recent CEO really had a difficult time with this, but he scored very high on optimism. And so what he said when everybody was worried that the company was going under, all he kept saying was, "Don't worry, we're going to get through this. This is going to be okay." But he didn't acknowledge the fact that people were freaking out. And that's a very special skill called empathy. But when we are not empathic, we're saying to people, "I don't get you. I don't understand you. I don't understand why you're reacting the way that you are." But when we know more about empathy and we learn that it is about recognizing others' perceptions as their truth, then we can help them to feel heard and understood. And that creates a deep interpersonal connection that is going to be valuable over time. So people say, what's the ROI for emotional intelligence? It takes too much time. And they much prefer the old style, autocratic, authoritative leadership. When in fact, that little extra investment of time into building relationships with people pays off in the long run. It leads to greater levels of employee engagement, greater levels of retention of top of those incredibly talented people that you spent a lot of money recruiting and hiring and onboarding. So we need to get better at these skills in order to realize the returns on many of the investments that we make as organizations. So leaders who take this this approach, the suck it up princess approach, they probably score high in stress tolerance. When things are out of control, things are stressful, everything's coming at them, they seem to handle it really well. And for many of them, ironically and interestingly, it's because they're not really in touch with their emotions. They don't believe emotions are important. They focus on the processes and the systems and the technology, and they ignore the stress that people are experiencing. If you do that, if you have trouble with reality testing, this could be you. If you don't use empathy, you can absolutely ignore the emotions of others, but you do so at your peril. You can't judge and determine whether your teams are psychologically safe. And if you haven't heard about psychological safety, if you think that that might be something that is worth creating in your organization, you're going to want to read the work of Amy Edmondson. Amy Edmondson said in her book, The Fearless Organization, she said, many managers don't have the emotional intelligence skills to create psychological safety, which was found by Google's Project Aristotle to be the number one factor in high-performing teams, was psychological safety. So what is psychological safety? It's when you feel safe to talk about mistakes. Mistakes are not punished. Mistakes are to be learned from. Conflict is embraced. It's like, you have a different opinion than I do? Great. Let's learn from each other. And it's a very different approach than the previous punitive type of culture that many teams experienced as a result of autocratic and authoritarian leadership. So as you know, we human beings are moving away from the authoritarian, hierarchical, autocratic approach to leadership and moving towards a collaborative, participative, inclusive relationship with employees that causes people to feel great about being there and want to be there, look forward to coming to work. And these workplaces can absolutely be created, but you have to know about it first. You have to want it. And then you have to learn how to create that by developing your skills in these areas. So let's take a look at mistake number four here. Mistake number four is, we've always done it this way. Did you ever hear that? Why do we do things the way we do them? Because we've always done them this way. It's always worked for us. And it's always interesting to ask the question, who's this us that the person is talking about? We think that the high EQ competency here is impulse control. Impulse control is great. Again, as I mentioned, you need impulse control to avoid taking actions that you might regret later on. But where it gets into and becomes problematic is when you deliberate too long. And spend too much time thinking something over, getting more information, maybe do one more focus group until you take a decision. That's when it can be problematic, when it takes up too much time and the opportunity's missed. Which EQ competency we think is low for this individual or the person making this type of mistake is low flexibility. Now, low flexibility can sometimes be rewarded in the organizational world because you've got leaders who have a vision and are sticking to their vision. Where low flexibility can create problems for you is when you're faced with new information, you can't change your perspective or your approach. This always amused Jill and I when we were watching the news during COVID, and they would do these interviews on the street with on the news, and people would say, they, being the people in charge, are always changing their minds. And we just turned to each other and smiled. Of course they're changing their minds. They're learning new information. In the face of new information, you change your mind. And all of the information that that was being put out was based on empirical evidence, was based on science, and people just couldn't handle the fact that people in charge change their minds. That's low flexibility. So we have to be flexible and open to new ideas, and this is the only way innovation happens. Under mistake number four, there's no innovation, and there is very likely no psychological safety. People feel unsafe to give their best ideas, to speak up and talk about how they view from their perspective, sometimes being on the front lines, how things could be so much more improved. Because they have a privileged position, a privileged perspective. And if you're not going to your front lines and asking them what they think should be done, then there's a missed opportunity. It's the people who are doing the work up front and close and personal, they're the ones you should be asking these questions of. It was why the concept of management by walking around became so popular in the 80s and early 90s. This came from Tom Peters' book, In Search of Excellence. He talked about management by walking around. Go get your coffee in the morning and walk around and learn from the people who are doing the frontline work, what the real issues are, what's really going on in your organization. And then be open to innovating, be open to new ideas, be open to doing things differently. I like this little hello sticker. Hello, I'm leaving my comfort zone. For those of you who go to networking sessions and hate them, for those of you who go to conferences and hate sitting down next to a group of strangers, this is a real missed opportunity. These are the very people that you can partner with, that you can learn from, that you can add to your network, that you can exchange business cards with and call later and say, hey, what are you doing over at your plant? How does your system operate with respect to these things? And again, as I mentioned, nobody ever did anything great alone. It was always together. Together we can do anything. Alone we're completely limited, but together we can do anything. And so again, that sometimes requires leaving your comfort zone and reaching out, meeting people, talking to people, and getting to know them, building relationships with them. It's one of the advantages and real opportunities of conferences. And so if you haven't collected a fistful of business cards at this conference, make sure that you know everybody at your table before you get up and leave the session today. And for those of you at home who are not able to be at the conference physically, the next time you go to a physical event, take a bunch of business cards and meet people in your industry sector. Learn from them. Talk about things you could do together, ways that you could share learning, etc. And be innovative, but it requires leaving your comfort zone. Mistake number five. I picked this picture of Boris Johnson because of, you remember when he was telling everybody to not go to parties and then he had a party? So this do as I say, not as I do comes from a position of entitlement, from a position of privilege. You may have met these leaders. They feel like Novak Djokovic, was under different rules. Different rules applied to him, I'm entitled. There's that stratified entitlement, and you're feeling like you're above others, and that you don't have to do what other people do, when in fact that puts people off. It has a negative impact on teams. It has a negative impact on workplaces when leaders delegate things that are unpleasant for them, the things that they would never do in some cases. So the high EQ competencies here might be independence. It might also be self-regard. Again, self-regard so high that it's out of balance and you feel like you're somehow better than others and that you are entitled to certain privileges as a result. The low EQ competence here might be social responsibility, that you don't feel like you have a responsibility to the group or to the team, and so you can offload work onto them, not necessarily delegate with authority or delegate strategically, but simply offload work you don't want to do. People get to know that they don't like it. They feel like it's unfair. And fairness is a critical and important thing in the workplace. If people sense that things are unfair, that you as a leader are treating them unfairly, it's a discretionary effort killer. People are not going to bring their best selves to work in a workplace which treats people unfairly. So it's a critical and important thing for leaders is fairness. So this do as I say, not as I do, doesn't cut it. It doesn't wash. And it's a common mistake that we've heard about over and over again. Mistake number six is this idea of fixing the roof in the rain. It was John F. Kennedy who said the time to repair the roof is when the sun is shining. The classic example here is where leaders don't invest in the relationship, they don't take time to get to know people, but then in times of stress and pressure, they feel like it's okay to ask an employee to stay overnight or stay the weekend or whatever, to ask them to do extra duties above and beyond their role or description. Because they have the power to do that. And it is a relationship killer. It is a discretionary effort killer for sure. But what we encourage all leaders to consider is once again, fixing the roof when the sun is shining. But if you're out there, and my example, my personal example comes from Christmas lights. We spent some time in Calgary, and I don't know if you've ever been to Calgary, but in the winter, it's really cold and miserable. And if you leave your Christmas lights to do in November, December, you're going to be freezing your fingers off trying to put your Christmas lights up on your house or on a tree or wherever outside. And every time I say, why did I leave this so late? And on and on. And there I'm trying to fix the roof in the rain. It's just not the time to do it. The time to do it is when the sun is shining. And we don't often think about that. So the belief here is that a leader deserves a trust because of a position. In reality, trust is earned. I heard someone say something funny about trust, and it was that trust comes in like a turtle and leaves like a Ferrari. And there's a lot of truth to that. It takes time to build trust. It's not a simple, easy, quick process. But it can be broken and damaged so quickly and so easily when we aren't paying attention. So the higher EQ competencies we thought here for this, having this attitude, making this mistake of fixing the roof in the rain, self-regard, that you feel pretty confident about pretty good about yourself, and you feel like you should be able to expect trust just because you have the positional authority, when in fact, of course, that's not the way it works. You might be high in self-actualization, feeling like you are at the top of your game, you're at the top of the organization, and you should be able to say whatever you say. But where you might be lacking is in interpersonal relationships, understanding that relationships are built through sharing of the self, through sharing about what's beneath your surface, by sharing your emotions, by sharing what your thoughts and beliefs are with others. That's how relationships are built. That's what people can relate to. The root word of relationships is relate. And unless you're talking about what's going on beneath your surface and not just about the technology that your company or your organization focuses on, then you're not building effective relationships for the future. And the other low competency here might be impulse control. You want it done expediently, and you're not going to be patient enough to put in the time, because patience and impulse control are correlated, and you're not going to be patient enough to put in the time to develop the relationship that is necessary. So that's mistake number 6. Let's move right along and talk about, by the way, I'm just going to ask the organizers, if you could just type in the chat box what time you want me to wrap up and turn it back to you, that would be great. Mistake number 7, Jill had a boss named Nick, and we came to call him No Stick Nick, and so that became his moniker, and he was the kind of guy that would never be held accountable for any of his poor behavior and his poor decisions. And we got to thinking, what is it about this guy? And we thought, what is the belief here that you don't have to take any accountability for things? And again, this is such a frequent issue. In fact, we just had a kind of an interesting coaching conversation with a leader the other day, and this person talked about all the staff that were kind of flowing through their workplace, and this individual blamed it all on the employees. It was all their fault that they weren't staying, and not taking any responsibility or accountability for the fact that she was the one who was doing the hiring, and she was the one who was onboarding them and training them, but she took no responsibility for the fact that they couldn't, as she said, they couldn't cut it. She was blaming it on the fact that they were millennials. Millennials have all these high expectations, and she was talking about all of the poor characteristics of millennials, and not taking any responsibility or accountability herself for what she really needed to take a look at. Some of the beliefs that there are probably many that can come up here in mistake number 7 is that conflict is scary or bad. If you believe that conflict is scary or bad and are conflict avoidant, you are just creating problems for yourself, because conflict results because of different perspectives. And of course there's different perspectives. We're different people. We are going to have different perspectives. We're going to have conflict. And better is to embrace conflict and say, hey, what can we learn from learning more about each other's perspectives and opinions here? The other potential belief here is that I am untouchable, and there was a bit of arrogance, and we felt that that probably was the case for Nick. Both of these played out for Nick himself. The high EQ competence here might be flexibility, that you might be quite flexible and are okay with a wide range of outcomes or decisions, that you don't necessarily have specific or detailed expectations or even objective expectations, and that there's a great deal of independence in operation there as well. But those come back to bite people, because when you are too flexible, then it's like anything goes, when in reality, it probably probably should be. Here's the standard. This is what we're working toward. These are our objective outcome measures, and these are what we're going after. And then the high independence is too high. Again, it's off being a bit of a lone wolf and not necessarily operating within the confines of the organizational expectations, off in a silo somewhere. And that's probably not good. And then we've got a couple of low EQ competencies here. Some people might feel low in self-regard. Often when people avoid conflict, it's because they don't feel confident themselves, or they avoid conflict because they don't feel confident themselves. And if you don't feel confident yourself, if you don't know yourself and your own capabilities and really feel good about those and trust those, then perhaps you will be conflict avoidant. Reality testing is, again, when people don't necessarily know or understand their biases, and the fact that we are all biased, and that we frequently are assuaged with unconscious biases. We need to really make more of those unconscious biases conscious. How can we recognize and understand when a team is probably biased because there are too many similar individuals on that team? How can we encourage diversity on our teams and in our organizations? The idea of unconscious bias is a great argument for encouraging diversity on organizations and reducing the impact of unconscious bias. Okay, so no questions yet. Wow. Might be because it's late in the afternoon. That might be a reason why there's no questions, or I'm just doing such a good job of telling you everything that you need to know that I'm answering all your questions before you even have them. Now, I kind of doubt that, but in any case, that's a possibility I'm going with. All right, let's take a look at mistake number 8 here. Okay. Make room for my ego, and the image there of the person shoving others out of the picture so that they can take their share of the light. And this, when this happens, when people are unable to get out of their own way, when they take the belief that they are central, superior, and deserving, then this is potentially a real relationship killer, and also dramatically hampers leadership effectiveness. If you feel like people are there to serve you, if you feel like you are somehow better than they are, and if you feel like you deserve to be in that position, there's a problem. Actually, this central, superior, and deserving notion comes from my partner Jill's lifelong work in the area of violence against women in relationships. She has run groups for women and men who abuse women in relationships. And one of the things that she noticed was some men and some women come from a different relationship perspective. Abusive men frequently come from the perspective of feeling like they are somehow central to the relationship. They are superior to the other person, and they are deserving and entitled to what they get from the relationship, which is an extremely different model than what many women come into relationships expecting, which is much more collaboration, much more partnership, and much more sharing. When you try to come from a relation into a relationship with this different paradigm, if you will, sometimes it makes relationships so challenging that they have no chance of success. So we need to shift the paradigm, first of all. We need to shift more to this relational standpoint, this relational perspective that all relationships are negotiated and compromise is involved in all relationships, and no one is central, no one is superior, and no one is deserving of any more than the other. When we can get to that place, then we can truly connect. and we can truly have a deep and meaningful relationship characterized by trust, loyalty, commitment, the kinds of things that you as a leader want from your employees. And people say, well, come on, intimate relationship, intimate partner relationships are different than employee relationships. Really? That's a traditional belief. And not that we're going to have the same kind of intimacy in a relationship with an employee. Intimacy is simply a measure of the depth of relationship. And yes, they can be intimate relationships. You can know a lot about each other. You can truly care for each other. And this is possible, but it's kind of battling a traditional belief about relationships in the workplace. And we need to challenge those traditional beliefs. We need to challenge the beliefs that I clearly remember my father saying, I don't come to work to make friends. And that may be a belief of some people that you know as well, but it's really a traditional, outdated notion. People come to work now to create a social network too. That's why COVID was so hard on a lot of people. People want to get to know each other. They want to have fun and socialize together. And this is can be critical and important for a workplace. The high EQ competency that we figured here was emotional expression. People who have big egos love to express their emotions. And this is this was really demonstrated by Donald Trump. He clearly views himself as central, superior, and deserving. He clearly expresses a lot of emotion. If we look at our EQ model, if we're trying to sort of diagnose Donald Trump, he's very low in emotional self-awareness. He doesn't really know what he's all about. If he did, he'd make more sense. But as a result, he doesn't make sense. He's simply a stream of consciousness with respect to his emotional expression. When he's coming up with ideas like injecting bleach during a press conference and asking the guy who's responsible for overseeing the pandemic response and saying, couldn't we just inject bleach? Clearly, that's someone with a huge ego, with no understanding, no empathy, and no ability to connect with others. So yes, high emotional expression, but not necessarily impacting on people in the right ways. When emotional expression is used in the right way, you as the person expressing your emotion, you don't have to carry that whatever burden that is for you on your own. And you're letting other people get to know you. And again, with that, with others knowing you, that's when trust has an opportunity to be built. Trust cannot be built in an atmosphere where there's no emotional expression. It can't happen, at least not effectively. What's the low EQ competency here? Low emotional self-awareness, as I mentioned. So that's mistake number 8. When egos are in the room, when people want to do things because it is some sort of a vanity card for them. it reminds me of an organization that, because I was, when I was younger, I was pretty good at writing proposals, and I got a lot of institutions, publicly funded institutions. I got them a lot of money, and it was well known for it. So this president hired me to write a proposal. When I saw the request for the proposal, I told him, "You're never going to get this proposal. This is held by this grant is held by this incumbent, and there's no way we can compete with them." But he hired me anyway, and I wrote the proposal, including directing a team of people that we sat around a boardroom table in a very fancy hotel in Eastern Canada, and wrote that proposal, knowing full well that we wouldn't get it, and we didn't get it. They didn't get it. And that was ego. That was all about ego for him. He needed to feel like he was at least in the game, even though he didn't have a chance of winning. That's mistake number 8. What's mistake number 9? Mistake number 9 is the get-her-done leader. The leader who's all about priorities and deadlines and making sure that all the boxes are checked off, that sort of thing. And the belief that you have to have in order to in order to make this mistake is that productivity is the only workplace measure of success, when we all know that productivity is not the only workplace measure of success. Other workplace measures of success include whether we are attracting top talent. Is there a lineup down the street to work here? And that only comes about from excellent leadership employee engagement. What are the employee engagement survey? What are the employee engagement indices telling us about how engaged employees are? And isn't it interesting that employee engagement is really just how people feel about working there, about being there, about looking forward to coming there every day and spending time with the people they spend time with the technology they spend time with, etc. A quick little comment here. A good leader is only a player on the team. He's not the team. Absolutely, Daniel. Thank you for that. Yes, I love those comments. Yeah, they're not the team. And that is something that we kind of find as a bit of a theme here among all of these mistakes, is that people are embracing and clinging to traditional beliefs that are changing as we evolve. And as the younger generations come into the workplace, they have different priorities. They have, and people say they're wrong or misplaced priorities. Well, no, actually, they're just different. And we have to look for the opportunities that are there. And what is it about what they expect and what they want that we can actually turn to our good, to improve our organizations? High EQ competence here might be self-actualization. People feel like they're really doing the right thing. And self-actualization is all about feeling like you are doing the exact right job for you. And we don't necessarily always find that early in our careers. There's always something lacking, something missing, something that we would like to be different. And so whenever we're faced with a fork in the road, we try to take the one that we think is going to lead to greater levels of fulfillment, greater levels of meaning and purpose for us. That's self-actualization. So we're always self-actualizing. But when you feel like this is it, you've hit the jackpot with the role that you're in, it's possible, and if that's characterized by productivity, it's going to be difficult for you to change. And what is really necessary and important here is empathy, and we often find that's low, because that get-or-done attitude, mentality, has its impact on others in the form of stress. I used to think I had to get there before he did in the morning and leave after he left. And after a few weeks of doing this, when I first started, he finally came to me and said, "I couldn't help but notice that you do this." And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "You know, you don't have to." He said, "I don't care what time you get here, what time you leave. I just care about the work that you do when you're here. If you get your work done, if you achieve these objectives, you don't. I know you got a young family, and it's just crazy for you. I don't have a young family, so that's why I come in early and leave late." We had to have that conversation, and he turned out to be the best boss I ever had. And I talk about him a lot, but he really, I learned a lot about what I learned about leadership from him. And one of those was that, that productivity is not the only workplace measure of success. Okay, what's mistake number 10? Then we can have a bit of a conversation, looking for some questions from you and a bit of discussion here. But mistake number 10 is all about gossip in the workplace. I know I shouldn't tell you this, but you wouldn't believe what so-and-so did or said. I remember clearly this boss that I had that would tell me things about other people. And I had to laugh when later I realized that she was probably saying things about me to all kinds of other people. I thought that I was in a privileged position because she was sharing these things with me, but it was later on that I realized she was probably just gossiping with whoever was at hand about whoever was not in the room. And of course, the belief is that that you might appear powerful when you have information about others, you feel important, or you feel special or privileged or something because you have information that other people don't have. And maybe at the high EQ competency is self-regard there. Maybe you feel like that's your role, is to pass on that information or that that privileged information. And what might be low there is social responsibility or impulse control. And of course, if you have a responsibility to the group, to the team, to the division, to the organization, then you're not going to pass on gossip that you hear. You're going to say gossip ends with me. Oh, we've worked in some smaller communities, and you know, what's true about smaller communities is that everybody seems to know everybody's business, and we have to stop that if people are going to be able to trust. And to build trusting relationships with others requires that you know that when you share something with someone, it's not going to be known by everyone else. And so we sometimes have to remind people, and we have to role model this when people come to you with gossip, that you don't pass it on, that it stops with you, and that we don't continue that everybody knows everything kind of attitude. Because it's, again, it destroys trust and it prevents deep and meaningful relationships from becoming a possibility. Okay, so what else? Let's first of all just ask you a question. What else could have made the top 10 list? What have you seen leaders do or say? What would be in your top 10 list? So type into the Q&A box what you think maybe I missed. What's a top 10 mistake that you've seen a leader make that you'd like to share with the rest of us?
David?
Yes.
It's called now. So just so you know that the people in the room here don't have access to chat, so I'm just asking them to see if they have any questions.
Thanks,
anything Kalpna. In your top 10, things that you've seen.
So if someone puts up their hand, Kalpna, you can race over to them with the microphone?
Yes, Heather and I can
awesome,
do that.
Awesome,
I'll tell you one thing is with the top 10 is that I've sort of seen a little bit of in a former employer is the leader having favorites, very obvious favorites.
Yes, absolutely, Kalpna. And that's about our need for fairness. We have a basic human need for fairness, when that fairness is not there, wow, what a trust destroyer that can be.
Okay. Comments from the audience?
Do as I say, not as I do. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Rob, for that one. Micromanaging. Micromanaging is one of the biggest mistakes that leaders make, and I don't know that I necessarily include it in the top 10, but thank you so much for that, anonymous attendee. Yeah, micromanaging. People, and micromanaging is horrible because it makes you feel like someone doesn't trust you, like someone needs to be looking over your shoulder or even involved in your business. It's a terrible thing, and it's a motivation killer.
Ben? Okay.
I've had the opposite of that, of the opposite of micromanaging, not Kalpna. But just to be clear, but where it's, they're not involved at all, they're step really far away. So then when they step in and, you did this wrong, but you haven't shown me any way what to do. So I figured it out my own way. You're left really on an island to yourself. So it's kind of the opposite.
Absolutely. And people talk about that as being unavailable, right? When leaders are unavailable, it's like, well, what am I supposed to do here? No direction, no guidance, no structure, just leaving people hanging. And like, absolutely, like they feel like they're out on an island somewhere. And isn't it interesting that in the absence of feedback, we just have to assume that we're doing okay, even if we're not. There's no opportunity for course correction in an absence of feedback environment. Okay, well, we've got not listening enough, talking over people, not giving them space to express their thoughts and ideas. Absolutely. We need leaders to pay attention. And again, when leaders don't listen, you start to feel like it's not safe to contribute. And so you stop contributing. And the whole idea of capitalizing on human resources goes out the window because you're not leveraging the people that you've got at the table. What else do we have here?
I have a question here from the room.
Yeah. Well, yes.
Not really a question.
Or a comment.
But in the overall theme of things, as a leader, you need to be able to take all of those 10 things that you're saying that we're not supposed to be and use them to your advantage in your leadership role at different times. Do you not think that that's part of how you get there?
Sorry, I don't understand the question or the comment.
So you've said 10 different types of leadership that you shouldn't try to use, but to move things forward, you have to use all of those over time to get things to move forward. So you sometimes have to be more aggressive. You sometimes have to be more forceful. Sometimes you have to be just get her done. You've got to use all of those different components in the proper context to move things forward.
Yeah, I guess what we're talking about is about being aware that we are evolving away from a more autocratic or authoritarian leadership style. But I fully understand what the point that you're making, and that is sometimes you have to be autocratic or sometimes you have to be authoritarian. But what we're saying is that you do that with awareness and intention and knowing that there's a cost. And the cost is potentially in the relationship and the trust that you've built up. So yes, sometimes because of expediency in the face of a disaster or an incident, then yes, it's all hands on deck, and you got to start ordering people around for sure. And I think people understand that, but not every day is a disaster, not every day is an emergency, and the time that you take to invest in relationships with others ultimately will pay off in many, many ways. That's what I'm saying.
I have a question here.
Hi, I was just wondering, I haven't really had a boss like this in 20 plus years. And when I see this top 10, it seems like it's outdated sort of dinosaur stuff. Is this present day really happening? Is it common for people? Because it's not what I'm used to.
Well, good for you that you haven't experienced that lately, but we still hear these stories that are happening in workplaces now. This one case was the one of the most brutal dictators that I've ever encountered. And I heard that he passed away. And I thought, okay, so this is interesting. Are people going to, you know, what are people going to say about him? And everybody glowed about this guy and gushed about this guy. And I'm not sure what that's about, but he got results for sure. He got stock prices up. He did all those things that people wanted him to do, but he did it in such a brutal way that he left a trail of damaged relationships and negatively impacted people in his wake. So again, one of the jobs of all leaders is to get results and balance those getting results with the impact on people. And so how do you best do that? You do that by understanding some of the skills that we talked about in the model. That you first of all work on yourself, and then notice that you have an obligation, you have a responsibility to help the people that report to you to develop their EQ, develop their self-regard by acknowledging their good work, to help them to develop their problem-solving ability by addressing issues, emotional issues with problem-solving like procrastination or avoidance or worry. And we have to start talking about all these things because this is the only way out is through, and it is through conversation. And we have to start talking about things that might be a little uncomfortable for people to talk about, like emotions. And we have to learn vulnerability because we've not been taught it in our professional schools, but vulnerability is the only way to build trust. So we don't build trust without vulnerability. And so we have to sort of take this opportunity to step into the future. And many people have done that, and you're absolutely right. A lot of workplaces have absolutely entered the 21st century, but many have not. And many are still back in the dark ages with some of these things. And there are people who are still making these mistakes. I hear about them daily. So
any other questions from the room here? I have a question.
Yes.
And you talked about the situation with the person who, you know, in terms of delivered results and probably, you know, profits and all that sort of thing. But when you see someone like that who leaves a wake of disaster, I mean, you work with a lot of organizations. What is the role of the board with something like that? Because you see the results, but the phenomenal cost of turnover or absenteeism, because I've seen that with a couple of organizations, and I sometimes wonder, well, I know it's operations, but why isn't the board looking at this in terms of why is there so much turnover? It's not always the people leaving for frivolous reasons. As to me, it's a reflection on management or leadership.
Yeah, Kalpna, it's the pain-pleasure equation. So that board is experiencing the pleasure of a high stock price, and there's not enough pain. There's not enough retention issues. There's not enough turnover. There's not enough other pain that are causing them to be concerned and want to do anything about that particular manager. But in speaking with the people in the company, they are miserable. They're staying because the golden handcuffs or whatever other reason, but they're miserable. Their families are miserable because they're miserable, and it has a huge human impact. People leave the company that they could have kept. People, talented, wonderful people that could have really added value, left the company because they weren't going to put up with it any longer. So again, why doesn't the board step in? Too much reward and not enough pain.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any other questions online or in the room? Over to you, Ben.
Yeah, I'm just reading some of the comments that have been typed into the chat box. And so people talked about leaders who overstate the obvious. Yeah, they're kind of annoying, like the Captain Obvious in the Captain in the hotels.com commercials. Teamwork makes the dream work, said Kurt. Thank you for that. This one person was used as a scapegoat so a leader could avoid responsibility. Absolutely, that happens. We know that. Someone else mentioned narcissistic behavior. So we have that as well. People who are narcissists. And here we've got someone who's saying, you mentioned favoritism. Over the years of my leadership, I always find that I gravitate towards the better performers. And as such, I reward the better performers. And that can be seen as favoritism. Do you have a way of avoiding this? And the answer is, I think it's kind of natural to want to reward those top performers with your time, attention, energy, etc. But who really needs your time, attention, energy, etc.? It's probably the people who are performing less well. A way of avoiding this, again, it's the perception of fairness that we respond to, or the perception of favoritism that we respond to. So it is really trying to avoid any kind of overt behaviors which demonstrate that lead to a perception of some sort of favoritism. Have we seen a general lack or lower effective leadership from the newer generations, Gen Z, millennials, etc.? And I think the answer to that question, Joel, is I don't think so. I think we're still, as a society, and this is kind of globally true because I've worked in many, many different countries around the world, that we still promote people into positions of management based on their technical skills, their credentials, their achievements, versus whether they have the kind of qualities that we know that were in the best leader that we ever had. So I think that with respect to the generations, yeah, they're going to do it differently. They might rely more on technology. They might be more comfortable texting than picking up the phone and calling, this kind of thing. But it's just, in some cases, it's just different. But we can still be emotionally intelligent. even if we, you know, prefer texting to voice, we can still do that. And we probably still rely on email too much. Email is great for exchanging information, but terrible for working on relationships. So we have to abide by that. Here's another comment, no autonomy. We human beings have a basic need for autonomy. We like to be left alone to do what we do best. And if we don't recognize that as leaders, then we could get ourselves in trouble. There are many ways to get the job done, but the good manager can fret out the easier way with collegial input. Absolutely. It's that collegial input that I think is so critical and important. We have to be open to collegial input. We have to open ourselves up to relationships with many people. I feel like sometimes, okay, so now we got a lot of comments. So I'll just take care of these and then turn it over to you in a moment here. I feel like sometimes leaders use surveys, corporate or business unit, as a method of engagement. However, don't use the information to promote actual change. And in so doing, Stephen, they destroy trust. So the next time you get one of those surveys, you're going to think to yourself, why would I bother filling this out? They never do anything with the information anyway. So again, we have to understand when we use surveys, we need to close the loop on that and get back to people and saying, thank you so much for participating in the survey. This is what we're doing with that information. And that's what can be done in those situations. What's the best way to deal with a poor leader as a boss? Great question, Rob. And again, it's what are they doing? What's the impact? And sometimes it's sharing the impact that they're having. In a one-to-one meeting saying, I don't know if you realize this, but when you do what you just did in that meeting, it really feels like you just sucked the motivation right out of me. I don't really feel like working on that project anymore. I don't know if you realize that, but that was the impact, because there's a difference between intention and impact. Whereas leaders quite frequently have the intention to boost performance, they sometimes negatively impact performance, but that wasn't their intention. So sometimes we have to share the impact because impact is different than intention. Hi, David. Does that change how companies look at the human resources now that there is challenge finding qualified staff? Yeah, Diana, it's an interesting dilemma out there right now because it's so hard to find staff. So how picky can you actually be? That is a challenge. How are you going to balance getting good staff with the fact that you just need some staff and that they're hard to find right now? It's just a challenge. Leaders always take ownership before they hand out blame. Absolutely, Jason. Thank you for that. Yes. That's why the blame game is so terrible in a leader, is because if they're accountable for the performance of that division, that department, that team, then absolutely they need to take ownership. And finally, a different set of rules for different employees according to the employer preference. Yes, absolutely. There's that favoritism again. So thank you so much for all of your wonderful comments and your wonderful participation today. I really appreciate it. And I'm just going to review my last slide here. What can you do moving forward? Well, you can consider EQ assessment using the emotional quotient inventory or the EQ 360, the multi-rater version, and bring in this kind of training into your organization. Consider EQ coaching. Join us for our free monthly webinars. We have all kinds of webinars on topics just like this, things like toxic masculinity and psychological safety and vulnerability and all these kinds of other related topics. And finally, be a more emotionally intelligent leader. I love to hear from people after the fact. So if there's anything, any questions that you have at all, feel free to email me. We can always set up a call and talk further. So thanks so much for your kind attention and participation today. I will turn it over to our MC, who will wrap things up for us. Thank you.
Thank you, David.